Now, we just talked a lot about FSMA. GAP stands for Good Agricultural Practices, and that is still currently a voluntary program that farmers can participate in to receive annual audits for certification to meet certain buyer requirements. Group GAP is a program offered through the USDA that helps provide, well, in my opinion, better training for those farmers, and then also help manage the group costs, especially for smaller producers. So when we talk about GAP certification, there's lots of different ways that farmers can become GAP certified. Primus offers GAP certification, NSF, SQF, there's lots of different certifying groups. But right now, when I talk about Iowa Group GAP, it's going to be the USDA Group GAP program. So we currently have what we're calling the Iowa Group GAP Network. And right now, the group host is the Iowa Food Hub, which is based out of West Union. Partners include ISU Extension and Outreach, Iowa Valley RC&D became a new partner this last year with additional funding. The Wallace Center at Winrock International provides space for the different groups across the country to have monthly meetings and hash through different questions we have as these groups emerge. And then, of course, the USDA Ag Marketing Service. The Iowa Food Hub was a Group GAP pilot site in 2014 when the USDA was trying to figure out if this is an achievable model. Since then, Group GAP has become something that any group in the country can participate in. We currently have several specialty crop block grants, which help subsidize additional costs related to the certification. So a basic overview of Group GAP. It operates under a shared quality management system, or a QMS, that incorporates the requirements of a food safety standard. If any of you are familiar with ISO standards in manufacturing, it's the same type of thing. So we have a quality management system that dictates the SOPs and the different procedures for the different components of the group. The group has to agree to be audited by the USDA as one body. The group will perform internal audits of their member farms to make sure they're compliant. And then they also undergo annual USDA audits on a percentage of farms within that group. So for those of us who are more visual, it's a little bit hard. The big green box up the top is the USDA AMS group. They interact and communicate directly with the central group, which in the case of Iowa is the Iowa Food Hub. The central group then has their cluster of farmers that they work with. The grant we received this year to do an expansion with Jason's group now has us into two different regional groups. So we have a regional group in Northeast Iowa and then a regional group in Mid-Eastern Iowa. Within that regional group, we have each have a cluster of farms that we work to do regular inspections. And then the USDA feeds into all of those because they pick out a certain percentage of the number of farms to do their spot inspections. So every farm gets an audit internally, and then some farms are lucky in that they get another audit by the USDA every year. The advantage of Group GAP is that it improves group members' accountability and performance and helps really leverage the resources. It helps decrease documentation and maintenance requirements for group members who operate under a single QMS. So all the audit scheduling and all that communication flows through that central group. We maintain the members' compliance through internal audits, and it saves, ultimately ends up saving group members money through cost and resource sharing, which here in Iowa is a big deal because an audit can cost upwards of $1,200 per farm, per year.
Not with the group, right? With the...
Right, if you just went on your own, you're looking at least $1,200. Because we have to bring in auditors from outside the state, and it's a lot of travel time, which they bill out at the same rate. So when we did our group, the Group GAP expansion this year into the different clusters, this is the model that we followed. We did a training with those farmers that came in, provided them a food safety manual template, which now has been FSMA-tized. That's the word I made up. It includes a lot of the new FSMA language. So I'm not promising that you're FSBA compliant, but you're a lot closer than if you use some of the older templates that are out there. Once you get your template done and you start implementing the plan on the farm, there will be a farm visit, maybe, or if you're a first-year certifier, you will have to have a mock audit before we schedule a real audit to come to your farm. We just want to make sure that we catch any of those last-minute silly things that may have slipped through the cracks that you'll lose points on in a regular audit. After the mock audit's been complete, we'll do an internal farm audit on each farm, which usually takes 1 to 2 hours, depending on the scopes that you want to have audited. Every farm is also required to have at least one unannounced audit. That usually means, I like to say a week ahead, you get about a week's notice to know that we're coming back. Those unannounced audits or follow-up audits are usually about 30 minutes. Just going through records, checking to make sure everything looks still on track. Then the USDA will come in and do their audits. That actually happened this last week for us. We have 11 members, and their rule of thumb is the square root of your members is the number of farms that we have to inspect. So square root of 11 would be 3. So the food hub always gets inspected, and then there were 2 other farms that the auditor did that same day. And then the USDA will send in another team, and it looks like this year it'll be the end of October, that'll do the paperwork audit at the food hub to make sure that the system is working and that all the audits are complete and everything is working like it's supposed to. 2017, we doubled the number of farms that were participating from 5 members up to 11. I did not list the roughly 4 or 5 that I consider to be in transition. They are thinking about becoming audited, but for some reason, they decided not to completely jump in this year. And you can see where they fall on the map. We're always looking for new members. In order to make this project sustainable in the long term, we need to have at least 30 members in the group, just to make the money flow the way it needs to flow. Because there are costs. So for the group to run Group Gap, they've had to send internal auditors to training. Right now, there's 4 of them, which includes the group administrator, the farm coach, contracted auditors. They've all gone through at least 40 hours of training by the USDA to become auditors. Their staff time to create the QMS manual and documents, audit time, distance, traveling time, spend a lot of time with farmer training and plan building to answering questions. We have to do the farm visits and mock audits, and then also all the internal audits every year.
Is that 40 hours? Is that 10 hours each? Or is that 40 hours
40
each?
Each. It's 40 a week.
Each.
If you want to become an internal auditor, it's a week. But the good news is one of those days is PSA training. So you can shave a day off of your internal auditor training by going to a PSA class near you. In 2016, there were 5 members in the group. And this is the sheet from where it ended up falling up. At that, we divide things into things that we expect the farmer to share in costs and what the food hub assumes as cost. We do have, like I mentioned, specialty crop block grant money for GAP cost share that we did apply to the farmer share. And you can see that is not a typo. It did not cost our farmers anything to have an audit in 2016. And you see that 3280 is the number that we would have split out between the 5 member farms. That's $656 for those of you who can do math in your head. At that size, that cost is still not really any better than just doing a coordinated audit with a regular USDA person. So what do I mean by coordinated audit? If you were to call up the USDA and say, I want to have an audit, I want to have it on this day, and you just did it by yourself, it'd probably be $1,200. If you had a few friends that also wanted to be certified, that lived in your area, and you said, hey guys, let's do our audits in August and see if we can get the guy here at the same time, because then they split the travel cost, then they would split that $1,200 by 3. So if you do a coordinated audit, in our experience, it's about $600. So at this group size, you're not really saving much more than just coordinating with your friends. We hope that eventually by getting to that 30 group number, we're going to get to the point where an annual audit is $200 or $300 for farms.
How much?
Joe.
I was just going to add that we're talking to and trying to work with some of the auction houses to get their farms all under that, which would cause that to balloon up and drastically help those finances look much better.
How much does it cost per farm per individual audit?
$1,200.
Well, not. I mean, you said they're sharing the travel expenses, I guess, but then there's individual costs for...
Well, they will divide that $1,200, which, because you're going to multiple farms, it's going to be a little bit more than that. So it's about $600. That's that coordinated audit that I'm talking about.
Patricia,
if you do it outside of a group.
If you were just coordinating with your friends, though, you would have to come up with all your own QMS and all your own paperwork and everything else.
If you're coordinating with your friends, there is no QMS. You're just operating your own system. Okay. You're just talking to each other on what day can I get the auditor here.
But like you have like the value of what you guys are doing is also providing all this extra paperwork and the whole template versus if I was going on my own and calling up Andrea to say that we should get the audit at the same time, I would have been sharing all my own stuff.
It provides so much more flexibility because now farmers can actually add more crops to their audit scope and not have to worry about paying another $1,200 to cover the asparagus that they wanted in the spring. One example we had this fall is when we went to a farm and he wanted to certify his sweet potatoes, but they weren't quite ready for harvest. One of the things the auditor needs to see is that harvest procedure. So we also have to do an unannounced audit of that farm. So we put sweet potatoes on their audit knowing that in a couple weeks we're going to come back, do an unannounced audit, and add that crop to that scope, and it's much cheaper to have a member of Group Gap Network do that than to have to have the guy from Missouri come back up just for that follow-up add-on. So there's a ton more flexibility in what works best for your operation, for your harvesting, and those examples. So this is a legitimate USDA program. This is an example of a certificate that the farm would get. Your certification is good for 1 year. And under Group Gap, any farm that falls under that will have the note that they fall under the Iowa Food Hub's Group Gap program. Group Gap is more than cheaper, and Kayla started hitting on this. You get expert and peer coaching to help you increase compliance. You know, there's motivation for continuous improvement. I think one of the fun things is that, you know, when we're not in an auditing role, we can be cheerleaders for the farm and, you know, celebrate the successes with the farmer that, oh my gosh, you just added that new hand washing station. That looks great. And, you know, you start to recognize those things as they implement them on their farms. It's less like farmer versus auditor, and it becomes more of a peer piece. It's not so scary. It's a system instead of a snapshot in time. So it's about helping the farmer create a food safety culture on his farm and or her farm, and not necessarily about what do I need to have in place so that, because the auditor's coming and I got to make all the points. We are looking for more clusters. So if you have groups that are interested, you know, we think at this time it makes sense to have about 5 growers or more in a cluster to fall under the current QMS of the network. We would hope and expect that the cluster would identify somebody to be a coach for those farmers, and then we would also eventually want that coach to become and go to train to become an internal auditor, because then we can swap auditors between clusters. So you're not auditing the farm that you just coached into questions. So if you're looking for grants, it's probably about $3,000 to bring on a cluster.
Yeah.
Right?
I'd say more than
$5,000. Go for $5,000. Well, Jason, talk about your grant. How you're bringing the support that you're providing.
I wrote a specialty crop loss grant that would have been in 2016 that I started that last fall. That training, grant allowed me to bring in 5 growers in our region in East Central Iowa.
two of us to go to training in Oregon for a week. It was tons of fun in the middle of nowhere. And then I'm also paying for water sampling costs for the growers that are as part of this project. I just sent out an email to a bunch of growers, like, who's interested, and these five got back to me. That's how I selected them. Yeah, I would say the cost of the training, depending on where it's at. You know, we had to fly to Oregon. We had a week's worth of hotels. So I'd say it's almost $3,000 a person it was for us for that. So, yeah. Unless you find cheaper ways for room and board. So.
And that was to be one of the certified internal auditor.
Yeah, so I'm an internal auditor, and then Phil, who's the warehouse manager at the IFWD, the two of us went to the trainings. And I'm willing to, if you have questions about that question, I'm willing to even share my information with you, especially for office. It's kind of the language and the budget piece.
It's going to take a little bit to onboard new clusters. I mean, if you're in the window on the map, if you're on the map, we can probably add you pretty easily without you having to form a cluster. If you're not on the map, then you need to think about how can you support a cluster on your own, because it just becomes too expensive to send me, who lives way up here in that corner, to go all the way down to Kelowna all the time to do audits.
Was I hearing you guys right in that you're saying that eventually group, like GAAP, is probably going to become a law that everyone's required to follow anyway? Or
no.
You don't think so? Okay.
No, FSMA is the law.
Okay.
And the way I like to explain it to people is everybody has to follow the law. At this point in time, GAAP is still voluntary, and I don't necessarily expect it to become mandatory, although you will have buyers that will make it mandatory for you.
And many more are every day.
Yes. So I view FSMA as being the law, that's where you have to start. GAAP is this voluntary piece that says, oh yeah, I'm obeying the law and then some, and here's my annual certification to prove it. More and more buyers are gonna be requesting that. So it's a way, you know, eventually FSMA and GAAP are gonna become harmonized to the point where it does overlap. I pulled out publication from yesterday that we talked about on our team meeting, because I thought I had it in my head, the difference between FSMA and GAAP, and really GAAP does require more things than FSMA does for certification, but FSMA has more intense water testing, has more intense compost record keeping, and is currently gray on recommendations for manure use and soil amendments, but that's being firmed up. But otherwise, a lot of this stuff carries over, and it becomes just a vocabulary change.
So is it that the FSMA is a lifetime certification, and GAAP is a yearly, or am I?
So FSMA is not certified.
Or, okay.
GAAP is a certification.
Okay, so GAAP is, and that's, you have to get recertified.
Your training is a life, for FSMA, is a lifetime training.
Okay, that's what I meant, yeah.
At this point,
FSMA sticks with a person, GAAP sticks with a farm.
Yep.
Gotcha. Okay.
So GAAP, you have a on-farm food safety plan that you follow, full of policies and procedures. That plan is not necessarily required for FSMA, but they do say it's a really good idea. And you can use the same plan for both. But one of the training requirements of FSMA is that you attend not just any GAAP training, you have to attend an approved training, which PSA is the only approved training at this time. It's the only one that FDA is allowing people to claim as an approved training.
One other thing that a lot of farmers that joined our group did, when they were getting ready for their audits, getting their plans together and stuff like that, they were really concerned, like, well, I gotta fix everything on my farm, from the field all the way down to my delivery van or whatever. And we had to back them off the ledge and be like, what's great about GAAP is they don't have to audit everything in the first year. They can just audit their field packet, their field harvest part, because field harvest is scope. Here's my test.
Okay.
Field harvest, well, there's every farmer's got to do scopes 1 and 2, which is your field harvest and your...
Well, general pasture.
general questions. Yeah. And then when you get into scopes 3 and 4, scope 3 is covering your washing and packing kind of area, and then scope 4 is actually transportation and storage. So almost the majority of our farms in my region did not do scopes 3 and 4. They just did the field harvest and the general questions this year. Next year, as they make those modifications to their packing or their delivery systems, they'll do those other audits. A buyer may, though, request a farm to get audits on a certain number of scopes. It's very rare that buyers are requesting audits with certain scopes.
And honestly, I don't know that buyers necessarily understand all the complexity of GAP to be able to say, thou shalt have scope 1, 2, 3, 4. They just want to see a certificate. So, it all goes back to that continuous improvement. So that was a discussion with several of Jason's farms was, you know what, it's okay, your pack shed, you don't feel like it's ready. We're going to do scopes 1 and 2 this year and get you certified there, and then we'll work on doing 3 for next year. Because we want it to be something that the farm embraces and continually tries to become better at and more efficient at.
Can you give us an example of some of the buyers that
your distributors? So Hy-Vee Distribution Center, Capital City Produce, LaFredo, your distributors for sure.
Okay.
Walmart. Although Group GAP won't help you get into Walmart because Walmart wants a harmonized GAP audit, and that's not what we have at this point. Some of the food service people at the university, so what's Cordell?
Bon appetit.
Bon appetit. We've run into some nursing homes, so because they're a high-risk population, they want to see GAP certification. Yeah.
What would you, if a farmer wanted just a mock audit or a kind of visit, coaching kind of thing, what have you been telling people would be a cost when you travel to this area?
Right, so I will have to give you a quote at the time. It just depends how far away you are, but generally I'll do a desk audit of your plan for $75, and then if you want me to come out to the farm, it's $150 unless it's too far, and then we might add some extra mileage to it.